Sun Valley, Idaho. A place to train, a time to reflect.
If the younger man beats the older man, then Michael Spinks will have done something that no light heavyweight champion has ever done. Defeated a heavyweight champion.
Spinks, the aggressor.
I can say to the judges, the referees, the promoters, the kids where the sun don't shine. And since we're on HBO, that's my big black behind.
But I knew from 12 on, it had to be my fight.
Michael Spinks escaped with a split decision. So after a historic first fight and a controversial second, IBF heavyweight champion Michael Spinks takes the next step to the unified title. Tonight, he faces European heavyweight champion Steffen Tangstad as the Heavyweight Unification Series continues on HBO. Sets in the desert, we're live at the Hilton Convention Center in Las Vegas, Nevada, where in the main event, Michael Spinks defends his IBF heavyweight title against Norway's Steffen Tangstad. It's scheduled for 15 rounds. Also, we'll show you some of a fight taped earlier tonight between heavyweight sensation Mike Tyson and former cruiserweight champion Alfonso Ratliff. And so it's Michael Spinks, a boxing enigma, who once more steps into an arena to convince the public and maybe even himself that he is a heavyweight to be reckoned with. It was only 5 months ago that Michael Spinks stepped into this same ring in the Hilton Convention Center and won the controversial decision over Larry Holmes in their celebrated rematch. That's the history. Tonight, it's the next chapter. Hello, everybody. I'm Barry Tompkins, along with Sugar Ray Leonard and Larry Merchant. Second title defense for Michael Spinks. And Ray, we mentioned the fact that this man is an enigma. There was a boxing writer who once said, he's so good, it takes an expert to see it. Now, you're an expert. Is he that good?
Well, thanks for being so nice to me, Barry. One thing about it, Michael Spinks has initiated himself as a heavyweight on two different occasions and becoming a heavyweight champion by defeating Larry Holmes. I personally feel that Michael Spinks is not a full-fledged heavyweight, but he can deal with any heavyweight champion or contender. But the best is yet to come, because as we get closer to the unification of this division, I think people at home will be able to appreciate and see a lot more of Michael Spinks.
Larry Merchant, when we were in England doing the Tim Witherspoon fight, I asked some of our cohorts on the BBC about Steffen Tangstad, if they'd seen him fight. And they, in describing him, borrowed a title of an old Beatles song, and they said, Norwegian Wood. So let me ask you, why Steffen Tangstad?
Well, basically because every American heavyweight champion since Jack Dempsey has tried to fight these foreigners because they have these nice faces just sitting up there like pumpkins waiting to be hit. But sometimes the faces do hit back, most memorably Max Schmeling and Ingemar Johansson. But for the most part, such matches can be traced to the sometimes curious business ethic of prize fighting. You try to fight the least amount of fighter for the most amount of money. The only other thing I can figure out is that American heavyweights are beating up on European heavyweights in some way to pay them back for what those European tennis stars are doing to Americans at the U.S. Open.
This one's a little bit more violent. We'll see what Steffen Tangstad brings to this dance then. Well, it's been a long and a rather ponderous road to the heavyweight championship for the IBF title holder, but Michael Spinks thinks of this not as an individual sport, unusually as a team sport. This is the story of two men. One hits the harsh pavement of New York City, dealing with boxing as an industry, walking the streets like any other businessman, readying himself for another tough day at the office. The other migrates to the mountains of Sun Valley, Idaho. He jogs to work every morning, 5:30 a.m. One takes the elevator to the third floor. The other takes and delivers punches. One carries a briefcase full of notes and important documents. The other carries a jump rope. Butch Lewis is the promoter. Michael Spinks is the fighter. Their story began back in 1976. Their first encounter was far from a coincidence. The Summer Olympics in Montreal. The United States boxing team took home a treasure chest full of gold, and a young man from the streets of St. Louis won the 165-pound division and caught the attention of one very interested observer.
I met Butch Lewis July 31st, 1976. After every match, the winner would go to a certain section in the building or in the forum where we would be interviewed. And I met Butch right there.
Michael said to me that at the time he didn't think he wanted to turn professional. He didn't want to become a professional fighter.
And he called back and forth throughout 76, on into 77, and then he called me, and I think he told me that he had signed Leon. And then after a month or two passed, I decided to turn pro too.
But Leon first caught the public's eye when after just seven pro fights, he shocked the world by beating Muhammad Ali. Both Leon and Michael were fighting under the promotional auspices of Top Rank Incorporated and Bob Arum. Butch Lewis was vice president of Top Rank at the time. Leon's fortunes turned sour after his celebrated upset, and as Leon became the butt of bad jokes, Michael let his pro career slip away.
And now, all of a sudden, the wolves and the leeches start to come out of the woodwork and surround Leon.
A dream had been shattered, you know, or a big mirror or a big portrait of Leon and myself in the glass had been shattered.
That wasn't the only shattered relationship. Butch Lewis and Bob Arum also parted company.
Whatever would happen between Top Rank and Butch happened to me too. If Butch and Top Rank fell out, Top Rank and Michael Spinks fell out too.
As Butch Lewis Productions, Michael's pro career got off the ground. In July of 81, he won the light heavyweight title from Eddie Mustafa Muhammad, the same Eddie Mustafa Muhammad who 2 years later in Washington, D.C., would haunt not only Michael Spinks, but also Butch Lewis in the aptly named scandal, Weightgate.
I know the deal. I know how they mess with the scales. You know, I know what the deal is, because I've been in boxing too long.
You think the people coming to see you promote a fight, Chuck? You out of your mind. They coming to see us fight. Remember that.
They came to the scale 2 3/4 pounds overweight. He refused. I practically begged him to just go run around the block. I mean, it's probably water. Let's make the weight.
I know he was afraid to fight. He was afraid of me, period.
I kind of felt there was a lot of jealousy and envy with Eddie in that fight in D.C.
Eddie Mustafa didn't like the way, I guess, Butch dealt with me. I don't think it was just our relationship. That's what it really was. He was jealous of our relationship.
By not letting the fight happen, that's better than beating Michael.
The latest chapter in this roller coaster ride of fortune was two extraordinary wins over heavyweight champion Larry Holmes.
Spinks has taken Larry Holmes' fight. Left hand a little short, but the second one scored. There's a right hand. Spinks, the aggressor. The combinations by Michael Spinks.
To date, the highlight of a career for the fighter and promoter.
I treat boxers like if I were the boxer and I would want to be treated.
We go together like peanut butter and jelly.
If it can happen, more relationships like this can perhaps develop in the sport of boxing.
If I had to choose between anybody on earth to be with, like that's who I want to be with.
We've cried together. We laughed together. We share one another's problems.
The relationship between Butch Lewis and Michael Spinks has produced the ecstasy of a heavyweight title and the misery of a fight that never was. It's a book whose final chapters have yet to be written. And so coming up here on HBO, the battle for the IBF heavyweight championship between the champion, Michael Spinks, and the European champion, Steffen Tangstad. It's scheduled for 15 rounds, with more on what appears to be at least an interesting matchup. Whether the fight stands up to the matchup remains to be seen. But with more comments on tonight's activities, here's Larry Merchant.
Prize fighting like life can sometimes be weird and crazy and nutsy. And tonight appears to be one of those times. Of the three heavyweight champions, Michael Spinks has the most credibility with casual fans as opposed to serious fans. He's been around for a decade, he's undefeated, and he became the first light heavyweight champion to beat a heavyweight champion, an aging one-time great, Larry Holmes, twice. And yet, despite all that, here we have Michael Spinks matching himself against an unknown, a suspect, a question mark, when there are a lot better heavyweights out there, which seems to suggest that he too is skeptical about Michael Spinks as a heavyweight. And speaking of credibility, what about Steffen Tangstad in Norway? In Norway, they outlawed professional boxing specifically to get because he wanted to turn professional. So he can't fight there, and he's an outlaw in his own country. Not only that, but he has a four-month-old son named Tex. But in Norway, they won't legalize that name. They say it's not a really good Norwegian name. Can't be called Tex. But Tex is called Tex. You can trust to that. Beyond that, Norway is very happy to collect the taxes on his earnings from professional fighting. And in spite of all of that, the Norwegian Tourist Board has hired this man to promote tourism in Norway because he is the most popular athlete in Norway. Ours is not to wonder why. Ours is merely to wonder whether Steffen Tangstad can indeed fight on this level for the heavyweight championship of the world.
And our host, please, Mark Hargett. Thank you, stand by. And action.
Yes, Steffen Tangstad from Norge, Europamester. Jeg kom hit til Amerika for å vinne over Marcus Spinks.
For those of you who don't speak or understand Norwegian, he's Steffen Tangstad, European heavyweight champion. He hails from Norway and lives in the oldest Scandinavian city, Tonsberg, an 1,100-year-old Viking town, a small, quaint city known for its shipbuilding. It has no poverty, no crime, and no professional boxing. In 1980, Norway banned pro boxing because of its violence and even made it illegal to train there. Fighters who choose to neglect this law are subject to prison sentencing. For the last 7 weeks, Tangstad has been preparing for this fight 5,000 miles from his home on America's west coast, where he can work out without fear of reprisal.
Oh, it feels great to be able to train without having to hide and try to find places to train. I mean, after they outlawed boxing in Norway, they also outlawed training for professionals. I'm only allowed to do shadow boxing and road work. So now I can do whatever I would like to do concerning boxing.
His philosophy, first get the body into shape, then put on the gloves. A disciplined student, he trains every day of the year. Like his counterpart, Tangstad has his own unusual style of training. He's brought with him from Norway his own exercise guru, advisor, and personal masseur, Egil Sobi, who back at home lectures on how to cope in stressful situations.
Steffen and I, we've been talking about this match for a long, long time, and we know how to tackle it. That's one of my professions, how to help him to tackle this stressful situation. He has a chance because the power of positive thinking, he knows that there's a lot of power in the man, and he knows the way to bring it out when it concerns him.
The criticism of Tangstad has been his inconsistency. He first won the European Championship back in 1984 with a victory over Lucien Rodriguez. Then, 4 months later, he lost the title in his first defense when he was knocked out by Anders Eklund. Tangstad referred to this fight as an accident that will never happen again. And Then this past April, with the European title vacant, he captured it for the second time with a 12-round decision over England's John Wetgar. It's no surprise that European heavyweight champions have not fared well in world title fights. The last to try and fail was the same Lucien Rodriguez who fought Larry Holmes in 1983. In the last 50 years, only one European champion, Ingemar Johansson, holds claim to having won a world championship. In 1959, he shocked the sports world when he knocked out American favorite Floyd Patterson in the third round. There appears to be a parallel between Johansson and Steffen Tangstad.
Yeah, Ingemar Johansson is a close friend of mine. This world championship fight was just 4 days after I was born in 59, 26th of June 59. I met him in Florida in 1980 when I first came over here to see some of the professional fighting over here. And before that he was my idol. He proved that it was possible to come from Scandinavia to become the heavyweight champion of the world.
The same way Spinks was given no chance against Larry Holmes, Tangstad is given very little hope against Michael Spinks. Yet, Tangstad strongly believes that when he steps out of the ring tonight, he'll take along with him the IBF championship belt.
Sure, I believe that. I'm a fighter and I like to fight and I want to fight. I want to fight for the title and that is happening now. And I'm going to give it my best shot. That's all.
So tonight, Steffen Tangstad will try and join his idol, Ingemar Johansson, as only the second European champion in a half century to win the world's heavyweight title. And here comes Steffen Tangstad, and if I had to describe that look on his face, Ray and Larry, I'd say concern.
Well, it might be called concentration. Unless you really know a fighter, you can't judge how he will behave in a situation like this.
One thing about Steffen Tangstad, even though he's a European champion and European champions have not had great success in the United States, he has fought 17 of his fights in the United States, so he's not the classic stand-up, straight-up kind of European fighter.
Well, Barry, judging Tangstad's style, one thing about it, he cannot outbox Michael Spinks. I think the best bet for him is try to out-hustle Michael Spinks.
Well, that's essentially what he said when we all sat and talked with him the other day. He said, I got to be on top of him, I got to try to smother him. He seems to take a rather realistic approach to all of this, and Egil Sorby, who you saw a little bit ago in that feature that we did on Steffen Tangstad, has sort of been his spiritual leader, if you will, so he's got an awful lot of things other than the physical going for him. And Egil had told us that, if nothing else, he knows his man is mentally prepared for this fight, and sometimes that's half the battle.
That's true, but one thing about it, it's one person in the ring, it's Tangstad. He has to make things materialize.
So it's kind of a cross, at least the mental aspect of it is, between Zen, cybernetics, EST, a little of a power of positive thinking. He's an amalgam, Larry.
And it'll all help him if he can punch.
Sort of always the bottom line in this sport, isn't there?
The main difference between a world-class athlete or a championship athlete and those who aren't usually comes down to a matter of quickness. And what we have to find out yet is whether he has the quickness to cope with someone like Spinks.
You saw his record. He has the one loss, that coming to Anders Eklund. He said it would never happen again. Here is a look at the last European champion.
Ingemar, yeah.
Ingemar Johansson.
He looks like some of the heavyweights we've seen in the ring recently. He weighs about 300 pounds.
But he also runs marathons. He's run two marathons, Ingemar Johansson. He lives in Florida now. And he is this man's idol. Floyd Patterson, the other half of those matches of the 1950s, the three of them with Ingemar Johansson. Floyd looks pretty good, right?
Yeah, he looks like the time he was a middleweight in the 1956 Olympics.
He told me yesterday he weighs about 175 pounds.
Light heavyweight, I'm sorry, Ray. And here is a graphic of the heavyweight series. This, in effect, you can see on the bottom, is a semifinal. The winner will go on to fight the winner of the WBA and the WBC. Mike Tyson, if he won earlier tonight, and I'm being a little coy because we're going to show you highlights of the Tyson fight earlier tonight, would fight Trevor Burbick for the WBC champ. although Burbick is now making noises like he might try to bolt this tournament, in which case it's possible that Tyson would wind up fighting someone else, like Pinklin Thomas.
And we will talk more of that story as you look at some of the celebrities on hand. Sylvester Stallone had a fighter here tonight in a preliminary card. Robert Duvall, of course.
Red Fox behind him. Robert Mitchum, a regular at these fights.
And, of course, Muhammad Ali, who inevitably draws the biggest round of applause. All looking up at this man, Steffen Tangstad, and now the waiting game as Michael Spinks, as is the norm in these heavyweight title fights, making the challenger wait. Let him think about it a little bit. So Tangstad mulls over the next hour or so. He hopes it'll be an hour or so. While the crowd looking to the entrance of Michael Spinks, who has made his way out of his locker room and heads toward the arena floor here at the Hilton Convention Center. Michael Spinks, incidentally, will make do tonight without Mackie Shillstone. Now, we talked about Mackie Shillstone during both the Larry Holmes fights and what an impact he had on making Michael Spinks a bona fide heavyweight. Well, he's not here tonight.
But one thing, I'm sure they're looking at Michael, there's something different. He's shaved.
There you see his weights in his heavyweight fights. He felt he was a little bit over-muscled and heavy in the second Holmes fight. Felt that he missed some opportunities because he wasn't as quick. Although I think Larry Holmes might have had something to do with that.
Well, Michael Spinks very loose, acknowledging the crowd and smiling at the crowd. Extremely loose. Do you like that attitude, Ray?
Oh, yes, because he's very confident. He knows exactly what he's capable of doing. And I think he's quite pleased with his training.
I remember, though, you telling me that you didn't want to be too loose. I remember against Kevin Howard, you were very loose, and you yourself said that really wasn't the way you wanted to be.
That was a matter of underestimation, I believe, Barry. But with Michael Spinks, I'm sure he's very confident, and he's aware this guy here wants to take his title.
But why shouldn't he underestimate this guy, as you did Kevin Howard?
Well, films play a major role in one's acceptance of a fighter.
And let's remember that this man hasn't lost a fight in 10 years. And no matter how you do it, that's impressive.
Well, we'll be looking at a different Michael Spinks in one respect. He doesn't have a mustache. He did yesterday when we talked to him, and today it's gone.
And there is the record of Michael Spinks in the 10 years since he won the gold medal at the 1976 Olympics. 10 defenses of the light heavyweight championship. That's Eddie Futch, the veteran trainer. Eddie Futch disqualified himself from both fights with Larry Holmes because he had trained both fighters, and now he's back with Spinks.
Well, there is a lot of electricity here tonight, which I must say is even more than I expected it would be. This fight has generated a lot of discussion. Now, whether, again, the fight lives up to the discussion remains to be seen. Michael Spinks still waving to the crowd, smiling at the crowd. Here is a look at the numbers on this fight. 3 years difference. Tangstad the junior. 13 pounds, a little more than 13 pounds. Tangstad will outweigh Spinks, who came in at 201. And the reach, which I've always found to be rather meaningless, frankly, because it is fingertip to fingertip, so really that doesn't mean all that much.
And there you see our punch stat, which gives you a quantitative look at these fighters. Michael Spinks in the two fights with Larry Holmes threw roughly the same amount of punches, around 45, 46 per round. And Steffen Tangstad in the one fight that we clocked threw 45, the same amount, landed a few less. Qualitatively is what's important.
Here are the rules of this fight. The IBF rules, the 10-point must system is the scoring. No three knockdown rule. There'll be no standing eight count. Championship fight, of course. Fighter can be saved with the belt only in the last round, and the ring doctor here in Nevada cannot stop the fight. So those are the rules. You can only be saved in the final round. Pretty much the norm. Right now, let's get up to the ring announcer, Chuck Hall, for the pre-fight introduction.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Hilton Center, where tonight the dynamic duo, Don King and Butch Lewis, in association with the Las Vegas Hilton Hotel, presents World Championship Boxing. These bouts are sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission, Freddie Little Chairman, with commissioners at ringside, Mr. Sammy Macias, Dwayne Ford, Herb Santos, and Sig Rogich. The executive director is Harold Buck. Representing the IBF at ringside is Mr. Bobby Lee. The officials assigned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission for the next bout of the evening, the judges are Charlie Spina of New Jersey, Dalby Shirley of Nevada, and Phil Newman of New Jersey. The timekeeper is Al Bicek. Counting at the knockdowns, Jane Broadfoot. The attending physicians at ringside, Drs. Donald Romeo, Cliff Omansky, and Elias Garnham. The referee for the next bout of the evening is Mr. Richard Steele. This is the main event of the night. 15 rounds of boxing for the IBF World Heavyweight Championship. Introducing, in the blue corner, formerly of Norway, now fighting out of Copenhagen, Denmark, weighing 214 and 3 quarter pounds, with a professional record of 24 wins, 1 defeat, 2 draws, 14 KOs. Ladies and gentlemen, here is the European heavyweight champion, Steffen Tangstad. And in the red corner, fighting out of St. Louis, Missouri, weighing in at 201 pounds. He is undefeated in his professional career, 29 wins, 19 KOs. He is the IBF heavyweight champion of the world, Michael Spinks.
There are, incidentally, 200 Norwegians here for this fight.
Mike, I gave both of you instructions in your dressing room. I want to remind you, obey my commands at all times. In case of a knockdown and you are standing, go to the farther neutral corner. Remain there till I tell you to come out. Is there any questions? Shake hands and good luck.
Michael Spinks is wearing a brace on his left knee. That's news to me. I'm not sure what it's about.
But of course, he did have a knee injury at one time. That was back in 1979. It did keep him out of action for 11 months. We didn't know anything about it.
Let's go.
He had a conversation, incidentally, just a moment ago with his brother Leon, who came into the corner, into a neutral corner, and talked to him about something.
Well, he's always worn that brace during the Olympics and during his amateur competition.
This is not a fight, presumably, of who, but how. How will Michael Spinks dispose of his man? Will he be impressive doing it?
Steffen Tangstad coming in without having broken a sweat. Now, it may just be that Michael Spinks kept him standing around. First round. Always appears to be awkward. Took a right-hand counterpunch from Tangstad.
Don't hold him, don't hold him. Let him go, Mike. Let him go.
Well, you see in Tangstad, he gets those hands out there, his jabs are pretty fast. He's not really a devastating puncher. One thing about it, his hands, his combination, he gets together, put them together quite well.
I do want to mention a couple of things that we do have. Harold Letterman has a left hook scores by Tangstad. We have Harold Letterman, who's our unofficial judge here at HBO. He'll be scoring the fight. We'll be talking to him Also, they'll be speaking Norwegian in Steffen Tangstad's corner, and we have Bernt William Asbjornsen, who is with us to translate, so we'll be able to give you up-to-the-minute Norwegian translation.
Michael Spinks gives you a target, then all of a sudden he vanishes because he's quite elusive up top. Very good upper body movement. Good stiff left jab by Michael Spinks. Spinks has not yet figured out the style of Tangstad. I think what's going to do it is a jab, as Michael Spinks continues to throw his jab to see opening in Tangstad.
Combination by Tangstad.
You know, it's the left jab, and Michael Spinks is starting to snap the head of Tangstad.
To force the action. Well, we want to remind you that coming up, Mike Tyson versus Alfonso Ratliff. Tyson, of course, perhaps the most talked about heavyweight these days. They're talking about him, even though he's not the champion, even more than the multi-champions. That fight taped earlier, and we will have it for you coming up a little bit later in this program.
Power with right hand. Okay.
Tangstad certainly doesn't seem awed by the situation. He tried to impose himself on Spinks like a big man on a little man in that round. Spinks got some jabs through, but Tangstad landed some of the heavier punches. Just to elaborate a little bit more on something we touched on earlier about Mackie Shillstone not being with Michael Spinks, Michael said he felt just a little bit slow in the second fight with Larry Holmes. And he felt that perhaps some of the training that he was doing away from the ring might have had an effect on that.
Well, but I always felt that Michael is trying to convince everybody that he's a heavyweight by trying to put on additional pounds. He doesn't need that. I think it has a tendency to take away his speed, his mobility.
Richard Steele asking timeout for just a moment. A big glob of Vaseline was on the shoulder of Tangstad, nothing more than that.
Because Michael can beat a lot of these guys with just speed alone. In and out combinations, a lot of footwork. His type of footwork.
That left hand caught on the gloves by Spinks. Spinks' jab now starting to find its mark, as you indicated, Ray.
Well, he needs to keep Tangstad off balance. Michael is complaining about something, probably the head of Tangstad. But Michael needs to just keep Tangstad off balance.
Good combination there. And that slowed Tangstad.
You see what's happening here, Barry. Michael's actually frustrating Tangstad. Tangstad will punch and rush his man in desperation. That's when Michael should be able to catch him running in.
And Spinks getting the better of that exchange. A lot of supporters for Tangstad in the crowd here tonight. As in my imagination, Rare, Tangstad seems to have a propensity to drop that right hand just a little bit every now and then.
Well, what happens, it's all through not being able to figure the style of Michael Spinks. Spinks' jab has been going through the defense of Tangstad, and I think it's a matter of frustration. It can't be fatigue because Tangstad is in shape.
Spinks now getting off quicker than Tangstad.
Watch for the left hook of Michael Spinks.
Punch or get out, punch or get out. Watch your head, watch your head.
Spinks very effective with the left hand.
You know, she's darting in and out. Michael Spinks giving him that movement.
That right hand was a little bit short.
Good round for Michael Spinks, who clearly felt that he was much quicker than Tangstad, and so became more aggressive than we usually see him this early in a fight.
Back him up. He's only effective when he's coming to you. You got to back him up. The double and triple hooks from the inside.
Got to strong inside.
I know he's strong inside. He's on the inside doing nothing, though.
You're out of there.
Yeah. All right. Okay. Ready?
Mm-hmm. So punch him, punch him, punch him. Relax and let the punches go. They hurt him. He's trying to put you away. But you got to put the whole thing on him right now.
You heard what they're saying in their pointers. In Spinks' corner, Eddie Futch is saying you must back up this man because he's only effective coming forward. In Tangstad's corner, they're saying this guy's trying to take you out. You got to go and put it to him. Spinks definitely fighting like the 7-1 favorite he is. And Spinks apparently feels that he is in control of the fight after a little bit of a slow first round for him. And incidentally, they are speaking English in Tangstad's corner, not Norwegian. Good right hand by Michael Spinks there.
It's quite frustrating.
That was the best punch of the fight right there.
It's frustrating because Michael can throw punches from all directions. Michael does not fight by the book. That's what makes it so difficult. Good jab by Tangstad there. Michael also, he was telling Eddie Futch that this man is strong. Especially inside.
Now Spinks backed up. I don't think he was hurt.
Tangstad has a lot of heart.
There was a right hand, and Tangstad is down.
I was just saying a lot of heart, but then he connected with the right hand, Michael Spinks.
Remaining.
You okay?
Watch Michael go to work.
Good right hand again by Spinks.
Michael's catching Tangstad as Tangstad is coming in.
And a left hand. Just trying to get through it inside of 30 seconds. Another hard right hand by Michael Spinks. And Tangstad still has 15 seconds to go.
This has been a much more action-filled fight than almost anyone anticipated.
Throw it on there. Relax. 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 Your punches are a little bit slow.
How do you feel? You okay? Pay attention.
Relax.
Okay. Gargle now. Come on. Give me the bucket. Gargle.
There you see, here you see what's happening here. And as I noticed earlier, he's just much quicker with the left hand in particular. And finally, the opening came with the right hand. And as Tangstad was trying to move away from the left, the right hand came right over the top. A three-punch combination, Ray, and that's the way it's written in the textbooks, I imagine.
Put the punches together, not one punch.
Says he wasn't coming out to look impressive. He was coming out to be sharp. So far, he's been both.
Not wasting any punches, making just about every punch count, throwing them from just about every direction. Another good right hand that Tangstad walked right into. And he's down. Is out on his feet.
You okay?
And Richard Steele lets it go on. Tangstad is just looking for a place to fall down. Richard Steele asked Steffen Tangstad how he felt, and Tangstad said, that's enough. Well, Steffen Tangstad, Ray, was not an upright European champion. He came to fight. He did fight. He just was in there against the Tiger tonight.
Well, like I said, Mike is not a full-fledged heavyweight, but he can hold his own against anyone. Michael Spinks, he utilized the left jab and comes with that dynamite right hand. I tell you, one thing about Michael Spinks' left hook is very, very short, very potent. There he was able to put Tangstad to the canvas. At this point here, Tangstad was out of it.
And here's a look at the second knockdown now. A right hand, and Tangstad behind a left. He goes down.
Well, Michael could follow up with the left hook. In fact, it's a very good habit to have. Once here, we have another shot as Michael Spinks throws the right hand and comes back with a beautiful, picture-perfect left hook.
And we'll take one final look at that second knockdown. It was a great right hand. He let Tangstad throw a left and came right over the top. So yet another European champion comes and goes, leaving Ingemar Johansson, who's here tonight, as the only European champion to ever take the title back. Here is our punch stat totals. Tangstad threw more punches, as you can see, but Michael Spinks, very effective, scoring on 58% of his punches. He had a very effective left jab. He didn't waste any punches. He finished very well. By and large, an impressive performance.
Well, Michael Spinks, without worrying about how much weight he put on, was more mobile, he was quick, he was fast, he could get in and get out and be very effective.
Let's get the official decision now from Chuck Hall. Chuck?
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Richard Steele stops the bout at 58 seconds of the fourth round. The winner by a TKO, and still the IBF heavyweight champion of the world, Michael Spinks.
You know, Ray, you've made the statement on numerous occasions, it's very difficult to fight an awkward fighter, and Michael Spinks, for all intents, is an awkward fighter. Tonight he was particularly effective, I thought.
Well, his type of movement frustrated Tangstad. Tangstad was never really able to enter the fight. He hit Michael a couple body shots, but didn't do too much damage. Michael used the left jab and countered with a beautiful right hand.
Everybody's been saying he's got to prove himself the ability to knock out a heavyweight. He did that tonight.
Well, I'll tell you one thing about Michael.
He's trying to convince everybody that he's a heavyweight. He's not a full-fledged heavyweight, like I keep stating, but he's effective and he wins. That's all that counts, though.
Tangstad did exactly what he said he was going to do. He told us he had to be on top of Michael Spinks. He had an effective first round, and it looked like Spinks was just kind of sitting back trying to figure out his style. Once he did, it was over.
Well, the mistake Tangstad made, he laid back, and then all of a sudden, Michael Spinks was able to push him back, and that was what Eddie Fletcher was telling Mike to do, to push him back. Michael did that, and Tangstad cooperated.
You could almost see at the beginning of the second round, Spinks say to himself, I got it now. My man can't hurt me.
Well, that's a matter of confidence, because once you're able to get your left jab in, your body shots, and every punch you want to throw, that's when you're able to actually set your man up for a knockout.
So Michael Spinks gets by the European heavyweight champion, came into 214, so now he's knocked out a heavyweight. Larry Merchant is with the winner right now. Larry?
All right, Michael, you are uncommonly aggressive, and certainly for the first time like that in a big heavyweight fight. Your assessment?
Well, first I'd like to say, all the praise on England goes to my Heavenly Father, Jesus Christ. I say hi to Mackie and Sandy in New Orleans. But I was asking you a question now. I was aggressive in this fight because what I was told, I said I watched the film only once, but it I didn't get much out of it, but they say he couldn't fight backing up. And, you know, I felt good. I was, he was strong inside. He knocked my head side to side a few times. That really made me a little leery of staying on the inside. But I just felt that I could control the match with his European style. He's still European no matter what. I thought I can get his inside and touch him in the body.
You're saying you felt that he was strong in the first round or two?
Oh, he was strong in the entire fight, but he just didn't. I mean, I made myself very unable for him to land the effective punches.
It seemed that Eddie Fletch was saying, said to you between rounds, you can't fight backing up, you must be aggressive. Did that kind of tactic surprise you against the heavyweight?
No, not at all, because I've been doing a great job in the gym. And I box heavyweight, so, you know, with my type of defense, you know, I feel good of going forward. You know, I can do a little bit of everything in the ring, and whatever I have to do against anybody, that's what I do. And I felt that it was important to touch him with my jab. If I find him with my jab, I can find him with everything else.
Does this make you feel now that you can handle bigger men?
Well, every man is a different man. And as each fight progresses, I'll take them as I feel. I'll take every fight as I feel. If it's important for me to go forward, I'll form a defense to help me get inside to go forward and do what I have to do against every man. I'm confident I can fight. I learned how to fight a long time ago, and it's just making these necessary adjustments. And I'm very adjustable, and I make adjustments like adjusting everything, everything in the world.
Let's try to adjust here for a moment to a picture of the knockdown, the ultimate, the knockdown that finally put him away. You describe it.
Well, I was waiting for him. I hit him with the good right hand because he had his left hand kind of low, and I came right back with left. I saw in the film how he swung. He shoots from the hips. Most of the guys that I been watching, the majority of boxers shoot from the hips. I probably except me. Even at times I shoot from the hip sometimes, but I saw that he was shooting from the hip after a couple punches, and I thought it was best to follow up with the left hook after the right hand, and thought he'd be open for it, which he was.
Now you prepared now to wait for the finals of the heavyweight series and to meet whoever is there?
Of course, I'm in the business to do it, and this is how I make my living, so look forward to me doing that. And I'd like to say, they just made me honorary chairman of Just Say No to Drugs, and I hope that we can help knock out the drug epidemic in our country just the way I knocked out Tangstad.
Thank you very much, Michael Spinks, and now back to ringside.
Okay, thanks very much, Larry Merchant. You know, the other thing, too, that I feel should be pointed out here is the fact that his corner was very organized. Eddie Fletch was back in there, and the one sage piece of advice that we heard Eddie Fletch say was you got to back him up. And Michael Spinks just substantiated that he didn't fight very well backing up.
Well, Eddie Fletch is a veteran trainer, and he knows exactly how to work another opponent. And in fact, he saw a weakness in Tangstad, the fact that Tangstad cannot fight backing up. And Michael Spinks went in there, became more aggressive, worked inside, got his right hand in, and he followed with a clean left hook.
So Michael Spinks is a knockout winner in the fourth round over Steffen Tangstad, the European champion, and he retains his IBF heavyweight title. A little bit earlier, a guy that everybody is talking about in the heavyweight division, Mike Tyson, fought a fella by the name of Alfonso Ratliff. Let's watch.
Listen to me now. Listen to me again, will you, Alonso? Look at me.
Look at me now, damn it. I want to talk to you. Remember what we said. Keep the fight clean, everything will be cool. First guy that messes up, it's going to cost them. Shake hands now and good luck to you.
Incidentally, Barry and Ray, the over-under for this fight, you can't bet on a winner here because Tyson is so heavily favored, is 5 rounds. You can bet on whether the fight will go a full 5 rounds or whether it will go beyond 5 rounds.
And I would think that the smart money is saying that it won't go 5. Round number one, Ratliff comes out quickly.
You have to see how Ratliff will post his fight, whether or not he's going to move and stick, try to stay out of harm's reach, or try to exchange punch for punch with Mike Tyson. His best bet is use that jab. Here, Ratliff is actually running. He's not actually boxing and moving and utilizing the ring.
That, of course, was the tactic of Mitch Green, one of the two fighters who has gone the distance with Mike Tyson.
What happened to a majority of fighters that face Mike Tyson, they are more so on the defensive. No one, very few fighters have taken the initiative to try to be offensive with Mike Tyson.
Well, Jose Ribalta did it, and did it actually relatively well.
Well, he's one of the few guys that was able to test the chin of Mike Tyson and exchange punch for punch with Mike Tyson. The other guys are more reluctant to stay back and just run, as Ratliff is doing here.
Yeah, so far it's a track meet. There was a right hand by Tyson, and that stopped Ratliff.
What happens, Barry, by moving away, all you're doing is giving Mike Tyson momentum. And when you give Mike Tyson momentum, you ask for problems.
A left and a right behind it. No knockdown, says Davy Pearl. That was a slip.
All right, Mike.
And Ratliff continues on the bike.
Hold it up. Hold it up. Don't punch it. Hold it up.
Ratliff fighting this first round, Ray, like a startled fawn.
It's like he's still trying to survive, Barry. He's not boxing at all.
And still 30 seconds remain in round number one. On his trunks it says Spartan, and I think that was an apt description of his performance in the first round.
Ratliff has been moving a great deal and not doing too much. What he has to do is stop every so often and fire back, throw some punches.
Well, he threw a right hand there, but I think he got out of there right after he threw it.
Well, what happens, Ratliff is anticipating a counterpunch from Mike Tyson.
right hand by Tyson.
What Ratliff can do, because he's so tall and rangy, he can try to catch Mike Tyson reaching in. Like so. That was a good opportunity there.
And there was a left hand, and Ratliff will sit it out.
Like a short left hook.
It was
a classic punch. And Ratliff doesn't, I don't think he'll get out of this round.
Tyson right on top of Alfonso Ratliff. Another sign, of course, that you look for is, can the man finish? And Tyson has left little doubt about that so far. Right hand, that should be just about it. Davy Pearl looking very closely. And that's all. It's over.
The bicycle had a flat tire.
And the rider
by
fell
a left
off.
Hook.
That, incidentally, is a much more important fight for Tyson than you could imagine, because it qualifies him for a shot at Trevor Burbick for the heavyweight title. Very Let's take a look and see how Tyson very professionally has cornered and has cornered Ratliff, and then a short left hook. And the reason, again, as I've stated before, his punches are so effective is that he's always moving forward, always looking to hurt the other guy. Now, as he moves in to end the fight, Ratliff is hurt. That right hand hurts him some more. It's just a question of letting him fall and get away from the ropes. Left to the body, left to the head, right to the head. Good night. There it is from another angle. A nice fight for Mike Tyson, in the sense that he had a big guy trying to run. A lot of guys are going to try to run from him. But as they said about Joe Louis, you can run, but you can't hide.
Well, Alfonso Ratliff won the press conference the other day, and he won the music contest before this fight, won the dance contest, and he won the stare down. Only one problem. Here's the official decision now from Chuck Hull.
Ladies and gentlemen, referee Davy Pearl stops the bout at 1 minute, 41 seconds of the second round. The winner by a TKO and still undefeated, Mike Tyson.
And joining us ringside here is unscathed, unmarked, and undefeated Mike Tyson. And Mike, your man once again tried to run away, but he stopped.
Well, what can I say? First of all, you know, I like to dedicate this fight to a dear friend of mine that passed away recently, Stuart Hilton in Montreal. And this fight is dedicated to him. And besides the point, I figured that he might try that from the press conference, from what he was saying. But other than that, I was prepared for it. I was sparring with a gentleman by the name of Mike Williams that was moving extremely fast during the sparring session. And when sparring with him and sparring with Alfonso Ratliff, it's like he was going in slow motion, and I was prepared for it all the way.
You know, one thing I noticed, Mike, in previous fights, you become more and more composed, and you compose very cool in there. What do you credit that to?
I credit a great deal to my trainer, Kevin Rooney. Pressure in a point that you must be a professional, stay relaxed at all times, and stay composed. No matter, sometimes you get hit, but you just have to take it. Don't show no emotions at all. And that's what boxing mostly is, it's emotions.
Is it frustrating, Mike, when a guy does run? Mitch Green ran on you a little bit, Ratliff does, and it's likely now you're going to see that a little bit more.
Well, it doesn't work at all, because they can't win the fight by running, and I put a lot of pressure on them. and the more they run, I just continue to throw punches. And I'm very elusive and they're not hitting me, so I'm ahead either way.
What happens now? You're looking to a Trevor Burbick fight, I know, but now there's some conversation that Burbick is supposedly signed with Jerry Cooney. What happens now for you?
Well, I have nothing to say because my managers, I'm sure, I have a great deal of trust in them, and they're going to do the right negotiations. And if it's a point of me fighting for the title, I'm sure I'm going to fight for the title, no matter who it is. But like I say, I'm number one in the WBC, number one in the WBA, so it really doesn't matter. I'm going to fight for the title either way.
Are you confident right now you could beat anybody around?
Most definitely, yeah.
Good win for you tonight. They're all good wins, Mike. Very impressive.
Thank you very much, Barry.
Mike Tyson right now with another one of the principals in the issue at hand, that is the Burbick-Cooney-Tyson trilogy. Here's Larry Merchant. Larry?
All right, Don King, Trevor Burbick is threatening to bolt from the tournament. Your view about that?
Well, first of all, just let me say, only in America, I'm excited about HBO having a fantastic show tonight, another sellout for HBO. In regards to Burbick, I think that Burbick is going to fight Tyson in November, and I think we have a rival promoter who has stooped to an all-time low now, trying to induce breach and tampering and tortious interfering with the contract Trevor Burbick had with us. So I really think that the threat is that Bob Arum is trying to make him bribe him.
Don, you're saying that you have a contract with Trevor Burbick to fight Mike Tyson, but that somebody else is offering him, as we understand it, more money to fight Cooney. Can he get out of that contract?
No, he cannot. He has the contract. It has been registered with the WBC, the World Boxing Council, and the chairman, Jose Suleiman. And he has got advances in excess of $100,000 on that fight, $125,000 check in precisely for Mike Tyson, so he knew that he was fighting Mike Tyson. But Trevor's not a bad guy. Trevor is just a guy that listens to a lot of people talking to him, and they're trying to induce him to breach.
All right, if he goes, what will happen? Will the WBC take his title from him? Who would Tyson then fight, and so on?
Well, first of all, I don't think that Trevor is going to leave. I think that Trevor is going to honor his commitment as he's always done. I think it's a very sad time when a promoter doesn't make fights. Now all he does is torpedo fights, and that's what Arum spends all his time doing now. However, if he should decide to bolt, then the WBC would have no choice but to remove recognition from him and go into the next situation. I don't know what that situation will be at this particular time. I'm looking forward to Trevor honoring his contract.
If the title is vacated by the WBC, would Pinklin Thomas, who is the top-ranked heavyweight in the WBC, then be free to fight Tyson for the title?
Pinklin Thomas is the number one contender in the WBC. After the time when that rule comes, we have to deal with that when it comes with it, but Tyson is ready to go. He's in the series. I think he'd have to fight according to how the series would go, because we are going toward one heavyweight championship on HBO and the World Heavyweight Series, and we're working very hard toward that end.
Thank you very much, Don King. And I should add here that Trevor Burbick, who is in Las Vegas, was asked to appear here to give his side of the story. Earlier tonight I said that sometimes the boxing is crazy and weird and nutsy, and this situation could be that. If indeed Trevor Burbick tries to bolt from the tournament, then what we have is a court case and maybe a delay in the tournament and who knows what. I'm not an expert in jurisprudence. About the fight tonight, Michael Spinks did better than some people thought, even though the opposition wasn't all that great. A lot of people in boxing thought we'd see a long, dull Michael Spinks fight, him standing on the outside, not exposing himself to danger and so forth. But somehow, all through his career, Michael Spinks has found a way to surprise us and his opponent. And let's give him credit for what he did. And let's not forget that Steffen Tangstad was indeed, let's be kind, a Norwegian professional fighter, alone in his country as a professional fighter. 4 million people in Norway. 1 out of 4 million Norwegians is a world heavyweight contender. At least he was before tonight. Now back to ringside.
Okay, thanks very much, Larry Merchant. And let us point out another championship that changed hands tonight. This one did change hands, and that was the IBF light heavyweight title. It was held by Slobodan Kačar. Bobby Chez today won it in a fifth round TKO. That fight held a little bit earlier, pardon me. Ray, we talk about the politics. There's been a lot of talk about the politics, and we talk about what's happening in the sport now with Trevor Burbick, and Bob Arum comes along and throws a lot of money on the table and says, make this fight, but he's under contract. You've been through situations, through some of the politics in the sport. What is it like? What do you suppose Trevor Burbick is going through? When people come to you and offer you a lot of money, how much involved is the fighter?
Well, guys are manipulated, misled, and misguided. I think in the case of Trevor Burbick, he's been taken for a ride, I would say. This is a good opportunity to unify the title. He stands to be one of the guys that is considered hopeful here, but it's just unfortunate, and hopefully we can resolve this.
Speaking of making news and speaking of politics, my man Sugar Ray Leonard here on the cover of Sports Illustrated, a fine piece by Bill Nack, but it is news, and so I have to ask, what is this? What does all this mean? Now, we're hearing out of Boston that Marvin Hagler has made a deal with Bob Arum, that there's a contract signed, that they've agreed. Now, what does it all mean so far as Sugar Ray Leonard is concerned, and what's the status of the fight?
Well, the unfortunate thing, I've not heard anything from Marvelous Marvin Hagler himself. I'm waiting to hear from him. Once I hear from him, Barry, then we can go on from that point. But ironically, the same individual that is creating this hoopla with Trevor Burbick, unfortunately, he's in the same my circle also.
So what you're saying, really, then, is that the contract is only a contract with Bob Arum. It has nothing to do with Sugar Ray Leonard. Am I correct?
You're right. As a matter of fact, my attorney will be going up to Boston to offer a counterproposal, something more feasible.
All right. So tonight, we have seen the IBF heavyweight champion, Michael Spinks. He has scored a knockout in the fourth round over Steffen Tangstad of Europe. They've been saying about Michael Spinks that in a sport of statements, that Michael Spinks is a question. Well, maybe he answered a few of the questions tonight. He wins it in a fourth-round knockout. Well, be sure to join us each week as HBO Sports Inside the NFL celebrates its 10th anniversary. Follow the action and get the inside story every week right through Super Bowl 21. Also, don't miss our next telecast of World Championship Boxing. It's a lightweight doubleheader between WBC champion Hector Macho Camacho, and he defends his title against Cornelius Boza Edwards, and WBA champion Livingston Bramble goes against the very dangerous Edwin Rosario. It's all coming your way September 26th right here on HBO. So for Larry Merchant and Sugar Ray Leonard, I'm Barry Tompkins saying so long from Las Vegas, Nevada. The executive producer of HBO Sports and the producer of tonight's telecast is Ross Greenberg. Tonight's show was directed by Mark Payton. The feature producers are Mike Whalen and Rick Bernstein. The associate producers, Dave Harmon and Steve Salvatore, and the production manager, Angela Mancuso.